what is going to happen, what will be the impact of this financial crisis on the services, and especially on the tourism, will be the focal point of our keynote addressee today. Mr. Jayas Ranjan, IAS, will be addressing us on that particular topic, and I have the pleasure of inviting him to deliver the keynote address. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much, Professor Sharma, and good afternoon once again, ladies and gentlemen. I'll be speaking about the tourism sector, how it has grown in the last two decades, what was projected about its further growth in our country, also in our state, and how the recent economic downturn has created an adverse impact, and what are the solutions that are appearing before us. Now tourism sector can be taken as a case study, because the same kind of scenario is true for various other sectors of our economy. It could be the IT, the software development sector. It could be any other knowledge-based industry. It could be industrial activity, so many other things. Now, like other sectors of our economy, our tourism sector has also become very, very prominent and has taken a major and has witnessed a major transformation from mid-1990s. As you all know, at that point of time, our economy was liberalized, and in the tourism sector also, India has opened up its shores. India has created more facilities. India has encouraged foreign arrivals, and because of the burgeoning Indian middle class, when the economy has been opened up, large number of other sectors, particularly software, other kinds of knowledge-based activities, they have also received a boost. In fact, the disposable income growth from 2001 onwards, every year we are seeing a disposable income growth of more than 10%. And most of the disposable income which is available to a household is being spent on travel, tourism, entertainment, retail. If you put all these sectors together, travel, tourism, hospitality, retail, entertainment, most of the additional income and the disposable income, after meeting all their requirements, whatever income is left over for spending on these purposes, most of it is being spent in this sector. And foreign tourists also, now we are witnessing in the last decade and a half that there are more number of high spending foreign tourists who are coming. See, earlier also foreign tourists used to come, but the category of foreign tourists who used to come to India, what are called backpackers, people who spend very, very little, who live in very, you know, these lodges and all those places. Most of them were the offshoot of the hippie movement. They would go to Goa, they will spend very little, they will just come here for some experience and all that. But from the mid-90s onwards, we are realizing that high-spending foreign tourists are coming, and their numbers is also increasing. In fact, in the late 2007, the figure of foreign arrivals touched for the first time 5 million. So 5 million foreign tourists visited India in the year 2007. And surprisingly, in 2006, the number was around 4 million. So every year, we were witnessing a growth of almost 20%, 25% of foreign tourist arrivals over the previous year. And these foreign tourists, I have the figure of 2006, the 4 million foreign tourists who came to India for various activities, they spent close to $8.9 billion. So the foreign tourists are coming in large numbers, they are spending more. That was giving a major boost to the economy. And this spending by the foreign tourists was also increasing by almost 30 to 33%. If you compare how much they spent in the previous year and the previous year, so a tremendous growth, not only in numbers, which was growing by around 20%, but also in the amount they were spending. That is growing by around 30%. And also, the government also had a very wonderful and a very coordinated campaign. Most of you would have seen it on television, in print media, what is called Incredible India. So Government of India is also promoting the possibilities of tourism in India by this campaign called Incredible India, and the Government of India and the state governments together are promoting this concept of Incredible India. So because of these three reasons, the first reason is the Indian middle class or the upper middle class, which is growing economically, which is having a higher disposable income, they are driving domestic tourism in India. Similarly, high spending foreign tourists are coming in India. They are coming in larger numbers. They are spending more money. And also because of the campaign of the Government of India called Incredible India, the tourism industry from the tourism sector rather, from the mid 90s till last year, or till till the middle of last year, till the middle of 2008, witnessed tremendous growth. In fact, tourism industry now contributes 6.1% to the country's GDP, and it provides direct employment to 20 million people. And if you include the indirect, the linkages with other sectors, which are also dependent on tourism, if you club the employment which is available there also, then the total direct and indirect sector employment provided by tourism is close to 40 million. So it is one of the biggest employers in the country. See, people talk so much about IT, only about 5 million people work in IT. But 40 million people are employed in the tourism sector, both in direct and indirect ways. And the other comparison between the IT sector employment and the tourism sector employment is that in the IT sector, only a certain category of employment is there. People who speak English, who know some programming, who are educated. But in tourism sector, it cuts across all extremes, from the most illiterate and unskilled kind of employment to the high-end employment. The entire spectrum is covered by tourism. So tourism can offer employment, tourism and the related sectors, to all possible diversities of skills, educations, backgrounds, etc. And as I said, there are a number of related sectors also, which also grow when the tourism activities grow. For example, handicrafts, it is directly linked to tourism. Transportation is directly linked to tourism. Construction is directly linked to tourism. And similarly, in indirect ways, agriculture, horticulture, poultry. So there are various sectors which are impacted by the growth in tourism. And that has been witnessed from the middle of 1990s till the middle of 2008. And the total size of tourism industry is growing at 9.4%. As I said, the contribution to GDP is 6.1%. That is also increasing every year. In the previous year, it was 5.8%. In the year before that, it was 5.35%. So every year, the size of the tourism industry and its contribution to the GDP has also been growing. Apart from getting tourists to India, the outbound tourism, that is Indians going abroad, that number is also increasing. And in 2008 figures have not yet been consolidated. We do not have 2008 data. But the 2000 data is available, and as per the 2007 data, 9.78 million Indians visited other countries for tourism purposes, which is an increase of 17.3% over the previous year. And this outbound tourism also from the middle 90s is growing by close to 12 to 15% every year. So almost 10 million people are going abroad for various kind of tourism activities. And as I said, close to 5 million people came to India in 2007. Now, so this is the rosy picture starting from 1990s, from the middle of 1990s till last year. Now, in the last few months, particularly 2008, there have been two, three incidents which have had a major impact on tourism activities. Apart from the global financial crisis, what is being discussed in today's seminar, India has also been branded as an unsafe place to visit. As you know, the Bombay incidents have taken place, the blasts have taken place, and so many other terror-related activities have happened. These two put together have dampened India's tourism growth, and it is, of course, the data is not completely, entirely consolidated. But instead of this 15% growth and 20% growth which was happening, from June onwards, from May onwards, May of last year, it is appearing that there is an 8% decline. The figures are yet to come, but a preliminary assessment shows that there is an 8% decline. And of course, there is lots of anecdotal evidence. See, one very good indicator of the growth and the increase in the tourism industry is the hotel room occupancy. Now, if you go to any of the hotels in here in Hyderabad, you can see that the occupancy has drastically come down. Most of the hotels have reported an occupancy which is just one third of the occupancy which was there last year. For example, in January 2008, if the occupancy in, let us say, some XYZ hotel was 70%, in January 2009, the occupancy is only about 20%. So there is a significant decline in the hotel's occupancy, not only in Hyderabad, all across the country. So that is a very good indicator to show that a downturn is happening. There is some impact on tourism sector also of this global meltdown. So as I said, there is a financial crisis which is to a significant extent contributing to this decline, and also this terror related activities which happened in Bombay and also in other places. Now if you analyze how is the relation of the global financial crisis with decrease in tourism activities, and also what is the relation of this terror issues with decrease in tourism activities, there are two, three linkages. The first is that most of these international travelers who are coming, if you categorize them, they are of three types. One are holiday makers, people who come on holidays, who go to different countries for holidays. Many of them are high-spending individuals who are now totally entangled with this financial crisis, because most of them are investors themselves. Most of the people I mentioned that this high spending foreign tourists come, most of them are themselves business people involved in various businesses, various commerce related activities, trading related activities. They are themselves investors, and because the entire investment world has been shaken up, these people have kind of got so entangled, embroiled in it, that going for recreation, going for tourism, going for holiday, that is no more a preferred option for them. They are preferring to settle their investments, settle their finances, settle their own issues, rather than going for holidays and all that. So that segment is not coming, not only to India, it is not going anywhere. Similarly, there is another segment which is coming to India very, very frequently. That is the business traveler. See, as you know, you can see in Hyderabad itself, you can see around your campus itself, some of the leading global companies have got their offices. Earlier, the situation was that most of these companies, they used to get international guests. Their clients will come, their partners will come, their associates will come. There'll be meetings, there'll be site visits, there'll be some deals to be signed. All that has come to, it has been reduced significantly. I won't say it has come to a halt, but it has reduced significantly. And most of the business travelers, when they used to come earlier, not only to Hyderabad, but any other city, they would spend some time in holidays also. For example, they will do their work for 2-3 days, take a break for another 2-3 days, spend a weekend here, spend a longer vacation here. That segment is also affected. Then the third segment, which I said, these backpackers, low budget kind of international visitors. Now that low budget visitors, also, particularly because of this terror activities, because in Bombay incident, you may be aware that lots of foreigners were specifically targeted. Foreigners who live in a particular kind of hotel, they were identified, they were targeted. So there is also some kind of a fear that India is unsafe for foreigners. People will be specifically targeted, there will be difficulties for them. So that segment has also more or less withdrawn. So for these reasons, we are seeing immediately an 8% fall in the tourist arrivals, which is likely to go further, because the year is not yet over. This analysis is only for the last few months. And once the financial year ends in March, we will have much more clarity about what kind of decline has taken place. Regarding domestic visitors, the scenario is not so bad, because particularly in Andhra Pradesh, and many other states also, domestic tourism is the backbone of tourism. In fact, many of you will be aware that Andhra Pradesh, amongst all Indian states in the country, ranks number one in terms of domestic arrivals. The highest number of domestic visitors, that is 125 million or 12 and a half crores, they visit Andhra Pradesh. And the next highest, I mean, after Andhra Pradesh, the most visited domestic location is UP, Uttar Pradesh, where about 7 million people go. So there is no match between 125 million and 75 million rather. So lots of domestic arrivals happen in Andhra Pradesh. Of course, they happen only in certain pockets, not that every place of Andhra Pradesh is visited by large number of domestic tourists. The domestic tourism continues. I have not noticed any significant decline in domestic figure arrivals. But the point is that the domestic tourism does not give you so much of earnings. The spending capacity of an international visitor is much, much more than that of a domestic visitor. And many of the domestic visitors, particularly in Andhra Pradesh, are pilgrimage oriented. So they come, they finish their pilgrimage. If they have some interest and some time, they sometimes go to other destinations, otherwise they go away. So these kind of tourists contribute very little to the domestic economy, both in the tourism sector and in the related sectors. So while the domestic figure numbers are perhaps maintained, there may be some small marginal decline. But in terms of earnings, it is the international visitors' earnings which really count. Now, in terms of opportunities, now this is the scenario, how the sector was booming earlier, how it was witnessing 20% growth, 22% growth, GDP contribution of 6.1%, which was increasing by 9.4% every year, how there is some kind of a break in that. Now, what can be done both at the national level and at the state level? Now, Government of India has started a few initiatives to really support this sector. And one of the initiative to attract more and more foreign visitors is to give some special offers to them. For example, there is one offer of Government of India that if anyone is coming to India for the third time, that is repeat visitor, a person has come once, a person has come the second time, if the same person is coming the third time, the government will make that person's visit absolutely free. The person will be provided free air tickets, the person will be provided free stay in Government of India hotels, and various other facilities will be extended. So this is a campaign basically to attract repeat visitors, because people, as we all know, India is a vast country, and whoever has come to India, very unlikely that he has covered the entire length and breadth of the country. He might have gone to some few places, but as we all know, there is a huge potential in every state practically in India to really explore and enjoy a tourism break. So this is one initiative. Similarly, Government of India has started another campaign in conjunction with the Incredible India campaign, which is called the Atithi Devo Bhava campaign. Basically, it means that the visitor is to be respected, basically. I mean, the visitor is like a guest. The visitor has to be cared for, the visitor has to be made to feel secure. You might have seen some campaigns in which very popular film star Aamir Khan is featuring in those ad campaigns, and he is mentioning about some of these unhealthy practices which tourists face. So that is another campaign. Then India is, our Government of India is also participating in more number of international travel and trade fairs, more number of road shows. It is developing better quality promotion material. It is also doing lots of facilitation. Many of you may be aware that India is also a popular venue for medical tourists, particularly from the Middle East countries, from African countries, a few South Asian countries, and also some European and Western American countries also. Because the medical facilities which are available in India, first of all, they are also of very high order, the best caliber doctors, some of the most renowned specialists are available in India. And also the cost of treatment of certain kinds of disorders are much, much low in India as compared to these countries. And also waiting time. In certain countries, you have to wait for months together, perhaps years together, to get some kind of procedure done. But in India, it can be done overnight. So for these reasons, India was also becoming an important center for medical tourism. In fact, last year, close to 1 million medical tourists came to India. And Government of India has introduced a new facility, a special kind of visa for them, which is called M visa. So a person who is preparing to come to India for some medical purposes can avail that visa, which allows him multiple visit opportunities and certain other facilities if to that visa holder. Now, these are some of the initiatives which the Government of India has taken. Here in Andhra Pradesh, we have taken up two very strong measures which we hope will maintain the position of Andhra and perhaps even improve the position of Andhra as a preferred tourism destination. Some of you may be aware that in September, in the month of September, we hosted in Andhra Pradesh a major international travel convention, which is called PATA Convention. PATA stands for Pacific Asia Travel Association, and they have annual conferences. All the leading tour operators, travel writers, people connected with the hospitality industry, they are all members of that body. And every year they meet at some location in the world and discuss about the business opportunities, other issues, policy matters. And last year in September, this meeting was hosted in Hyderabad. It is very rare and very unique opportunity, first of all, for India to get this chance, and within India, for Hyderabad to host this. Normally in India, Bombay, Delhi, these are the preferred centers. But for Hyderabad to host such a major event was a unique opportunity for us. And we also capitalized on that opportunity. We presented, we showcased the diversity, the richness which is there in Andhra Pradesh. And it appealed and it impressed a large number of international visitors who came. And it appeared that large number of international arrivals will start happening in Andhra Pradesh also. And we will, apart from being number one in domestic travel, we will also become number one in international travel. But thereafter, these incidents, as I said, more deepening of this economic recession than the Bombay terror attacks and so on, all these have happened. Now, however, we are not dampened by all that disturbance which is happening around us. We have started two particular kinds of campaigns to maintain our position. Post-PATA, we want to capitalize on the goodwill and the positive vibes that we have received. The first is to create better awareness about Andhra Pradesh. For most of the foreign tourists, India, the impression about India is confined to only certain regions. If you ask a foreigner who is not very well-read and well-informed about India, he will only tell you about Agra, about Taj Mahal, about Rajasthan, about Goa, to some extent about Kerala, and the cities of Bombay and Delhi. His awareness is only confined to that much. He doesn't know about anywhere else in India, what is there to offer, what is available. So we have tried to dispel this kind of ignorance by giving more and more information about Andhra Pradesh. We are doing publicity through our website, through other possible ways, through print media, through electronic media, through road shows, through direct participation in trade and travel fairs, and so on. And we are basically emphasizing that Andhra Pradesh is really the essence of incredible India. Whatever is there in India to see and do and experience, everything can be done and seen and experienced in Andhra Pradesh also. So we are focusing on the richness, on the diversity, about the heritage, about the beaches, about the coastline, about the nature, about pilgrimage, and about the cuisine, about the handicrafts, everything which we all see and know in a very direct way ourselves. But since there are many who do not know, this kind of special campaign we are mounting. International visitors plan their holidays, and when they think about India, many of them consider India to be a difficult destination. They feel that it is not well organized, there will be difficulties, things will not be organized properly, things will not be systematic, there will be lots of hassle, people will try to cheat you, you will be disturbed, you will be harassed. This is the kind of impression most of the people have about India. And since we are inviting people to specially come to Andhra Pradesh, which is not so well known, in a way it is a new destination for people, these kind of apprehensions will be even more. at least when you go to Agra, when you go to Goa, at least some arrangement exists. Even if you do not know anyone, you can land up in Goa, you can find some accommodation, you can find some transport, someone will tell you where all to go, what to see, what to do. Similarly, if you go to Agra, there'll be some system which is existing. It may be system with lots of difficulties, lots of deficiencies, lots of loopholes, but some system will be existing. But people are not so sure about Andhra Pradesh because they have never come here. They have never experienced what it is. And so they feel that because it is a new destination, things will be even more haphazard here. So to counter that, we have started a system called customized tours. Under customized tours, the basic concept is that all requirements of the visitor, and it is not restricted only to international visitor, anyone who comes to Andhra, even if someone is coming from Delhi, Bombay, Calcutta, anywhere, Gujarat, Rajasthan, people anywhere coming from anywhere to Andhra will get this facility, which is called customized tours. Customized tour basically means that all possible requirements of the traveler will be met by us. Just to give you an example, suppose there is some person who is living in Delhi, he is coming to Andhra Pradesh, or let us say he is coming to Hyderabad for some work for 2 days, and he wants to spend 2 more days in seeing what is available here in Andhra, in Hyderabad. Now the way the customized tours concepts operates is that this person can see on our website what all is there in Hyderabad, around Hyderabad, for him to visit, for him to see, for him to experience. And each and every potential place which has even the slightest interest to tourist is listed on our website. We have given some description, we have given some photographs. So the person can choose, see the entire website, and he can select as per his interest that he wants to visit this, 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 and this place. And once that communication reaches us, then we take over meeting all his requirements. We can pick him at the airport, whatever kind of vehicle he requires, depending upon his budget, we can provide that vehicle for him. Wherever he wants to stay, all the hotels of Hyderabad are listed, starting from the 5-star hotels to budget hotels. Wherever he wants to stay, we can book the accommodation for him. Wherever he has chosen to visit, the places of his interest, we prepare an itinerary and we fast track his visit everywhere. Suppose there is some entrance ticket to be purchased for some place, we buy that entrance ticket beforehand, we keep it ready for him. He doesn't have to wait in any queue. If he wants a guide to be provided with him, it could be a Hindi speaking guide, it could be an Urdu speaking guide, it could be an English speaking guide. We have more than 50 guides speaking various languages who have been trained, who are with us. And during the many people who come from outside, they are interested in local shopping because they know that Hyderabad is famous for pearls, Hyderabad is famous for various kinds of handicrafts, various kinds of textiles. So we have tie-ups with some of the leading stores here. So if the visitor wants to try something, he will be taken to those stores. He will not be mixed with general customers. Lots of product information will be given to him. Good discounts will be given to him. Many people who come to Hyderabad know that there is a special cuisine here, which is very unique in the country. They want to try it out. We have tied up with some local restaurants. Table will be reserved if someone wants to try the local cuisine. And during the stay of that person, if any event is happening, there could be some cultural event, there could be some sports event, there could be some food festival, whatever is happening, that will be brought to his notice. And if he is willing to participate in that, his visit will be facilitated for that also. So these are the services which we provide under customized tours, end-to-end solution. Right from picking him up to seeing him off, meeting all his requirements, transport, accommodation, sightseeing, guides, local shopping, local cuisine, local events, everything is arranged for him in a hassle-free manner. So he doesn't have to run around here and there for transport here, accommodation here, guide there, sightseeing here. Everything is done just by sitting at home. And we also are charging actuals for all these services. There is no hike. If he wants a car to be given to him, and if I rent a car at 1,000 rupees per day, the same will be charged to him. If he wants to stay in some hotel where the rate is 10,000 rupees per night, I will also charge him that same 10,000 rupees per night. So everything is on actuals. Everything is done very transparently. So this is the concept of customized tours. And we have started publicizing this facility, and we are getting lots of inquiries because there are no other states which offer such facility. Complete solution end to end by a single agency, what is called a one-stop shop arrangement. You just have to stop at one shop and get all your requirements fulfilled. So these are some of the facilities. In fact, if any of your guests are coming from outside, you can also make use of this facility. So I'm sure that with these kind of initiatives, creating more awareness about Andhra Pradesh, providing this kind of a hassle-free solution to the tourists, more and more arrivals will continue to happen here, and we will be able to counter this global financial crisis, this economic downturn, if not immediately, then at least in the medium term. Because immediately, as I said, there are declines which are happening everywhere. There is an immediate 8% decline which may happen, which may go further. But in the medium term, these are the solutions which will be very effective in countering the global financial crisis. And this is what, in the morning also, when I said that every challenge also throws up opportunities. So in tourism sector, the government of India, our state government, and I'm sure other state governments also are planning in very innovative lines, and they are also doing something which will ensure that the tourism sector's fortunes continue to be very bright, continue to be very high. And I'm sure that whatever we are doing in the tourism sector throws up important lessons for all sectors of the economy. There is an opportunity to think out of the box, think creatively, and ensure that the regular financial activities progress as was projected, as was planned. So thank you very much for once again for this patient hearing.